Madam, good afternoon, madam.
Good afternoon, sir.
I don't think that some other student will join.
Okay, is it so? Any particular reason?
Because every day one or two students are joining. I don't know how many people are taken MSW 2.
So, is this correct that this is the course we are discussing now? Casework and counseling?
Yes, madam.
Okay, so I'll begin. Thank you for letting me know. So, what is your background, if I may ask?
I'm working. I hope you have taken class in even in first year I2.
Yes, correct. That's why I was just trying to be sure that is it correct that I have taken class first year?
Yeah, but I'm already passed all the first year classes. Only I had pending of this 16 and 17 this field work paper. That's what I had joined. This is Hanak.
Right.
So now I'm in second year.
Right. So I'm glad that you have clarified, because I have one referred to this document, which I don't know if you have seen. So I will refer to it before moving to my presentations. So have you seen this course material on casework and counseling, working with individuals, which is having block 1-4 units and subsequently moving on to...
Yes, madam, I have seen it. Yes.
Okay. Okay, so because if you have seen it, then I want to move directly to my presentation, because generally I discuss the module and then in that context begin my presentations.
Okay.
So I would like to, yes, begin with philosophical assumptions and principles. Can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am, I can see.
Okay. So I would like to take you through certain philosophical assumptions which are inherent in this course as it is structured. And obviously, there are some things which you are aware of, so I will skip those. But I will mention it as we move along. If any other students are joining, then they can join. So apparently, this philosophical assumptions for this course on working with individuals, casework, counseling are as follows: that every human being has inherent dignity and worth. As human beings, we are interdependent, and there are common needs which have to be met for growth and development of individuals, but this does not negate the uniqueness of the individual. So keeping in mind the individualization that we are talking of, the fact that the self is extremely important for growth, achievement, believing that each individual has the capacity to change, and that society in itself has an obligation to help those who do not have the means for realization of the potentials. It's from this background that this course on working with individuals has been designed and structured and operationalized. So sometimes certain basic things we tend to forget, which is why the philosophical assumptions are extremely important to refer to. And I think that I would like to begin today with these and with highlighting the core values of the profession in terms of they being the service element, the aspect of social justice, as I mentioned, retaining the dignity and worth of each person, highlighting the importance of human relationships. You want to close your audio so that Ignu Bhuvaneshwar, who's probably trying to do the recording, then it should not hamper the recording. And I would also like to thank Dr. Panigrahi and his team for giving me this opportunity to engage with you. So coming back to the core values of service, social justice, highlighting and respecting the fact that we tend to undermine the dignity and worth of each person whether they are our co-workers, our staff members, our clients, our customers, the target population, the beneficiaries, the organization personnel. Equally important is valuing human relationships in among all these stakeholders in the system. So the competence of the social work professional can come to the fore, his or her integrity can be utilized effectively only when we remind ourselves of the core values of the profession. Having mentioned what the core values of the profession are, it is important as part of this module to refer to the principles in terms of the following: individualization being the first, the second being purposeful expression of feelings, the third being controlled emotional involvement, the fourth being acceptance, the fifth being non-judgmental attitude, the sixth being client self-determination, and the seventh being confidentiality. Now, we will be discussing these principles step by step because they are extremely valuable in our practice component where the fieldwork pans out. Also, because when we learn the principles in the classroom and when we operationalize them in the field, we are confronted with dilemma. And those dilemmas have to be resolved by the professional. Also, because the professional is working in a team most of the time. So we need to discuss these principles in detail. Some of them I have highlighted at the outset as being some of the more difficult aspects which we tend to be confronted with. So there are many a time when we speak of individualization and realize or convince ourselves that there's nothing very much to bother about. But the fact remains that however much we acquire the degree of the Masters of Social Work program, or however much we think that we are mature and in an adult learner, in our personal lives or in our professional lives, we find reason to question ourselves whether we are truly free from bias and prejudice, whether our knowledge of human behavior, which is a huge term in the context of this module, is enough for us when we are working in the field. As professional social workers or as budding social workers, what is our ability to listen, to observe? What do we listen to? Is our listening limited because of our biases and prejudices? Do our observations tend to be colored with judgment? A lot of aspects require not just theorization, but unpacking if we want to be truly professional. So when we discuss the prerequisites for individualization, we think it necessary to highlight the fact, as I just mentioned, our freedom within quotes from bias and prejudice, our understanding, knowledge, and operationalization of human behavior in various facets of our working life, the ability to listen, to observe, to be non-judgmental, to move at the client's pace, to empathize with people, whether they are in a casework situation, in a group work situation, or in a community situation. And most important, to keep perspective. Our ability to keep perspective tends to be undermined by us as professionals. And this we will dwell on as we move along. So what then are the various means of individualizing? What do we mean when we say that we need to individualize each client, each beneficiary, each consumer, each service user, all of which are synonyms and have evolved over time in the history of the profession? What do we mean when we say we need to individualize each group member in a group work situation? What do we mean when we say we need to individualize each adolescent in a meeting undertaken in a community setting? What do we mean when we say we need to individualize every self-help group member if we are conducting a meeting of self-help group members in a given situation? So when we speak of individualizing, we need to understand that the context is not only that of casework or working with individuals, but it implies to other spaces as well. And we need to honor it for what it means and for how we are going to conduct ourselves. So when we speak of individualizing, we need to understand that it comes by our being thoughtful or expressing thoughtfulness in the details, in the way we approach the client, in the way we sit down in an office space or a community hall or a roadside to engage with a client or a beneficiary, in our body language, in the privacy which we wish or definitely require to retain in the interviews we conduct with our clients, in maintaining confidentiality with the data which they are providing, which is primary data, in taking care to keep appointments which we may have given because people are taking time out of their schedules. There are people who may be engaging with daily wage work or home housework. Women may be engaging in as homemakers, so they may need to take time out to engage in a conversation with you or to keep the appointment which you may have given if you are part of an NGO. How do we prepare for the interviews which we conduct with our clients? Are we able to customize our interviews based on the background of the clients, based on the education level of the clients, based on the problem or the issue which is at hand, based on the challenge we are confronted with, whether it's as sensitive an issue as a domestic violence case or a marital discord case or a case of child abuse, or a woman who may be engaging in sex work but who may need to reach out to you for help? There could be a variety of situations where individualizing becomes extremely important. So engaging with the client or the beneficiary, as they are used to be called, or the target group, or the consumer or the service user, as they are called more recently, requires a lot of flexibility in our approach, in our attitudes, in the skills which we bring to the table, in the way we engage with them over a period of time. Because this is not a one-off meeting that we are going to have with our clients. There will be a series of conversations, a series of meetings, some of which could be formal, some of which could be informal, some of which could be anywhere ranging between formal and informal. Some of them could be when we meet them in their homes, which are called home visits in the traditional sense. So whether they meet you at an agency, at an organization, or in an informal space, or outside their workspace, or in a community setting, or in a relative's or a friend's house, in every situation, the need to individualize has to be understood and practiced, fine-tuning what is required of us. And as I just mentioned, in the process, it requires that we learn skills, we practice necessary skills required for the situation and for individualizing the client. The second major principle, which is highlighted in the module, is that of acceptance, which is taken for granted a lot of the time. We tend to believe, accept, and convince ourselves that acceptance comes easily to us because we are professionals in the making, or because we are working professionals, or because we are already in the sector, in the development sector. But the fact and research has revealed that acceptance is one of the more difficult principles practiced by professionals. It's a principle of action wherein the caseworker or the professional social worker perceives and deals with the client or the individual, understands and acknowledges the strengths and the limitations of the client, which in itself is a huge task, because understanding, appreciating, acknowledging, processing, and accepting require a very positive attitude of a professional social worker. And sometimes we tend to forget as professionals that we might be assuming that we have arrived at analyzing the strengths and limitations of our clients. But sometimes it's not just about analyzing their strengths and weaknesses, but about being empathetic about them. So being empathetic about the strengths and weaknesses of the client, being able to bring it on board, to be able to discuss it with the client, given that the client or the service user might be going through a range of mental health issues because they are facing a challenge which has brought them to you or to the organization in the first place, requires that we ourselves also do a double check, or keep our co-worker or the agency staff or the agency, the head of the organization or whomever we are reporting to in that given situation, in the loop of how we are processing the client's needs and challenges. In accepting the client's or the service user's strengths and limitations, we also need to bring to the table an understanding of what are the congenial qualities and what are the not so congenial qualities of the client, which may be impacting the client's dealing with his or her, their problem at hand, or with the issue or the challenge with which they have approached you. A lot of the learning of the professional social worker arises from their understanding of what are the constructive attitudes, what are the destructive attitudes which the client has not been able to deal with, what are the behavior patterns, what are the personality type, what is the baggage which the client or the service user may be carrying, which he or she has not processed. And while doing so, we need to maintain the individual or the client's innate dignity and personal worth. We cannot undermine the client by saying outright, bluntly, or in an upfront way that, you know, half your problem arises from the fact that you are not open to learning, or, you know, your problem would go away if you would just calm down, or it's your background and your upbringing which is causing an issue. We cannot speak to the client in that way, which means our own skills and attitudes, which we have learned as part of the profession, require to be fine-tuned to accept the client for who he or she is, to accept his, her, or their situation, to accept their sexual preferences, their personalities, their backgrounds, their castes, or their class differences, which may have brought them to a particular situation. So acceptance in itself is huge, and that's why it's being broken down as part of this module for us to address it. What obstacles do you think emerge when we deal with the principle of acceptance in our working lives? Sometimes the obstacles emerge due to our limited or insufficient knowledge of the patterns of human behavior. Sometimes we ourselves as budding professionals tend to lack enough understanding of how and why similar circumstances would require that we deal with them differently because of the socialization and or the upbringing or the family type or the life experiences which the client brings to the table. Additionally, something which we as professional social workers tend to overlook is that sometimes there is non-acceptance of something in our own selves, in our personal selves or in our professional selves, which leads us to have a blockage of sorts in dealing with our clients or in dealing with our clients' issues. Sometimes we unknowingly use certain defense mechanisms which block our reaching out to the client in a productive professional way. And we tend to attribute to the client or the individual or the service user one's own feelings by saying, I think if I was in this situation, I would also have reacted in a similar way. Or by telling a woman who may have approached an organization with an issue related to marital discord that, yes, you are right. I too feel that if I was in your situation, I would have dealt with it. Those are all personal statements and personal judgments which we are attributing to the client, which may not be required and which we are not professionally sound. So our biases and prejudices definitely, as I mentioned a while ago, need to be addressed, need to be dealt with, need to be seen, need to be reflected on when we are dealing with clients. Additionally, we have noticed with trainee social workers or with budding professionals that they tend to give unwarranted reassurance to a client saying, aapka sab kuch solve ho jayega, aap bas mujhe bata do, ya sanstha mein aa jao, organization mein aa jao, agency supervisor se mil lo, ya agle hafte aap dobara aa jao, we will have another meeting, another conference, another session, and I'm sure कि आपकी प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व हो जाएगी. सो गिविंग अनवॉरेंटेड रीअश्योरेंस विदाउट प्रोसेसिंग व्हाट्स द क्लाइंट इज गोइंग थ्रू और विदाउट अंडरटेकिंग अ डिटेल्ड डायग्नोस्टिक असेसमेंट ऑफ सॉर्ट्स इज नॉट अप्रिशिएटेड एंड कैन सर्व एज एन ऑब्स्टिकल टू एक्सेप्टेंस. इट कैन ऑल्सो बी द रीजन फॉर डीरेलिंग a client's situation and of being told by a senior or supervisor or co-worker that we have caused unknown damage to the situation by giving unwarranted reassurance. So we need to be very careful in differentiating between acceptance and approval, which we may provide to a client over a course of time, which we think we would require to undertake as part of our counseling process. It can also lead to loss of respect for the client or over-identification with the client, as I just mentioned, that if we unfortunately or unknowingly have known of or have had a situation of abuse or violence or trauma, and we relate that to that client's trauma which he or she is brought in, we may tend to over-identify with them. And this is also not professionally sound and can be a reason for being one of the obstacles to the principles of acceptance, which we are discussing now. The third important principle in this module refers to purposeful expression of feelings. Largely, this entails the recognition of the client's or the service user's need to express his, her, or their feelings freely without fear of bias, without fear of being judged, without fear of being told that they are wrong, without fear of clamping up, without fear of wanting or needing to come back another time when required for an additional follow-up session. Largely, our clients or service users approach us as professional social workers with challenges that they're facing in their lives, and a lot of negative or not so positive feelings associated with those challenges which they bring to the table. It is quite common for our clients to feel humiliated or embarrassed, or feel that there is lack of acceptance from us as professional social workers if we are not careful in the way we communicate with them from the first session onwards, in the way we receive them in the organization, or the kind of attention we give to them when keeping an appointment, or even the fact that if they walk in unannounced and we are doing something very important at the organization, we feel uncomfortable in putting it aside. And that comes through in the session that we are having with them, or in the conversation, the one of the opening conversations which we may have with them. So our entire communication, approach, attitude, skill set has to be brought in such a way, and we need to come across in such a way that the client or the service user can have a purposeful expression of his or her feelings or emotions or challenges. And even if the client is facing mental health issues, which may come across in any of the sessions, we do not at any point in time express any kind of judgment or lack of approval or lack of acceptance of the same. So all these are therefore being flagged in detail, so that at the outset, the philosophical assumptions, values, and principles of the module we are discussing can be laid out, so that when we build on these, there is a reason for us to understand what it entails, and also for us to reflect on our need to revisit them, to revisit these as professional social workers. So these are going to stay with us for the rest of our working lives, and therefore they are being discussed at the outset on day one of this module. Is everything fine? Can we go ahead? Right. So what are the advantages then of purposeful expression of feelings, which we are propagating and encouraging student social workers and professional social workers to do? One, it enables the client or the service user to relieve his or her, their pressures, tensions, which are related to the challenges that they are facing, which has brought them with the problem at hand. It enables the professional social worker to understand more adequately the problem or the issues which the client is trying to explain to us, despite him or her being troubled or uncomfortable or humiliated or embarrassed, because none of us like to come forth expressing our inability to be able to solve a problem. So we need to understand that the client is coming to us with a lot of difficulty in even being able to having to reach out to a professional social worker for help. Despite it being called a helping profession, and despite many helping and caring professions, the fact is that professional social workers are not as accepted as many other professionals in the caring, in the helping profession. So the psychological support that a client or a service user might require, the physical support or the need for resources that may be also required by a client, requires that the rapport building that is undertaken between the client and the caseworker, between the client and the professional social worker, be the basis for future endeavors in enabling the client to arrive at problem-solving measures. In an attempt to deepen this casework relationship, it's essential that purposeful expression of feelings be encouraged, and the client be we be open to the client expressing their feelings in whichever way they think best. Sometimes we have noticed that some client walks into an organization, and in the first opening statement by the professional social worker or the trainee social worker, the client breaks down. and a good 20 minutes go in the client being unable to recover from the breakdown. We have had trainee social workers unknowingly telling the client that you stop crying and only then I can talk to you. Now the client is beside himself or herself and we have to give the client time. And that we have to understand that this is an aspect of catharsis which is required and could also enable us to build a working relationship with the client if we need to get the acceptance of the client and appreciate the fact that the client will wish to come back to us for further help. This also leads us to the fourth principle titled controlled emotional involvement. Controlled emotional involvement is the caseworker's sensitivity to the client's or the individual's feelings and understanding of their meaning, that what are those feelings, why are they being expressed, where are they coming from, what are being hidden probably, what is surfacing, what is superficially being expressed. And if we require a purposeful and appropriate response to the client's or the individual's feelings, how are we going to build the relationship with the client or the service user so that we are able to utilize this principle effectively? The next principle, which I am referring to and which I have already mentioned in passing, is that of having a non-judgmental attitude. So social worker excludes assigning guilt or innocence or holding the client responsible or accusing them of causing the problems or aggravating the problems because of their behavior or their circumstances. So our approach, as far as possible, has to be such that none of this message goes through in our interactions with our clients through verbal or non-verbal behavior of us as professional social workers or in our conversations with our clients, that you are being, the client, I mean, is being held responsible for his problems. So social work, we need to understand, includes making evaluative judgments about attitudes, which involves both thought and feeling elements. But it also requires that we are careful, discreet, sensitive, and empathetic in dealing or discussing with the client about their issues. But in our conversation, not being judgmental, not making statements like, ye to aapke saath hona hi tha, aap is tarah se soch rahe the, to आपने क्या सोचा, अच्छा कैसे हो सकता था. और समटाइम्स आवर ओन बायसेस रिलेटेड टू कास्ट और क्लास सर्फिस, व्हेन वी से दैट लो इनकम ग्रुप के लोगों के साथ के घरों में ऐसा होता है, या आप पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी से हो, आपकी कम्युनिटी में तो मारपीट होती है. वी कैन नॉट मेक सच स्टेटमेंट्स एंड वी नीड टू बी वेरी केयरफुल एज प्रोफेशनल सोशल वर्कर्स if we are unknowingly making such statements in dealing with a client because we are trying shortcuts. That is not the agenda of the profession, and that is not the approach with which we would encourage any social worker to approach a client. Therefore, this principle of having a non-judgmental attitude is extremely important for us to understand, for us to process, for us to learn, and for us to practice as part of our budding professional journey. Some of the obstacles also we need to discuss, which tend to surface in our working lives when we think or work around this principle of being non-judgmental. What I have mentioned earlier, of course, our own prejudices and biases, which we may not have worked around, which we may not have dealt with so far. Sometimes premature assurance to a client, saying that I have dealt with such situations in the past, I am very skilled, I am very mature as a professional social worker, Yes, Hona, I will speak. I will just go through the principles. I've seen your comment in the chat. I will definitely come to that. We will move ahead with this, and we will in the next 4 days take examples from the field in discussing the aspects which you are highlighting in the chat. So while I was discussing the probable obstacles to our being judgmental, we need to remind ourselves that when dealing with any client or consumer or service user, as they are being called now in international fora, we need to be careful about not giving reference to other people with similar problems or to the client's expression of his or her negative feelings as being a bottleneck in their journey of resolving the problem. And of course, last but not the least, our lack of self-awareness could also be a obstacle or a bottleneck in our being judgmental about the situation. We need to understand that theoretically this may sound extremely simple and straightforward, but when we are actually practicing in the field, we are not always mindful whether we are being judgmental or we are being discreet, or we are carrying our biases, or we are processing our guilt, or we are unpacking our baggage in dealing with clients. And therefore, these principles need to be practiced and learned while we are still studying the course and engaging with the practical component of field work. The next principle which we are discussing is that of client self-determination. So we need to recognize that the client has the right and the need to make their own choices. They have the freedom to accept our opinions or our thoughts on a particular matter which they have brought to the table. They have a right to reject our understanding or analysis of the case at hand, and the final decision making of whether to proceed with the resolution of the problem or to proceed with the course of action in a particular case rests entirely with the client. In some cases, yes, we need to accept that there are limitations to the principle of self-determination. It's possible that the client's or the service user's capacity for positive decision making or constructive decision making can come in the way as a limitation. There could be reason for the social worker or the agency personnel to believe that the client is facing certain mental health issues or is so overwhelmed with his or her problem that he or she may require support of the family or friends or those of the counselor to enable him or her to arrive at constructive decision making, and therefore serving as a limitation to right to self-determination. Limitations can arise from the cultural ethos of the client or also from the functioning of the agency. It's possible that the client may come to an organization with his or her or their issue, but may need to be referred to another organization for follow-up or as a referral, or may need to be referred to a psychiatrist or a team or a therapist if the counselor or the caseworker is unable to resolve the issue at hand, or to a mental health expert. So depending on the situation which the client is, we need to appreciate that a multidisciplinary team or a team of other professionals or other professional, one or the other professional may be required to be pitched in as part of the process of enabling the client to deal with his or her problem. And therefore, the stages of problem solving need to be discussed and need to be understood as inherent part of this principle. Last but not the least in this is the principle of confidentiality, which is the preservation of secret or confidential information provided by the client or the individual who is disclosing his personal life history or personal circumstances in the professional relationship. It is based on the rights approach, which means that the client or the individual has a basic right to confidentiality. Yes, in terms of discussing with a colleague at work, we may do so if we require assistance in understanding the problem or in dealing with the problem. But discussing it as a matter of pride, as a matter of engaging with a conversation which we may have outside the workplace is not acceptable and hinders the principle of confidentiality which we need to retain and maintain. So it is a moral and ethical obligation of the caseworker to maintain confidentiality about the client's data, about the advice which is being given, about the discussion which we are having as professional social workers in the helping profession, about the possibilities of the client accepting or rejecting the advice or the course of action which is being designed by the professional social worker. None of this is to be revealed outside the professional workspace. Even the case history files, which are maintained by organizations, are required to be kept under lock and key or as a confidential document provided to trainee social workers only for the purpose of learning, not for the purpose of circulating or posting on social media or other platforms, which hinders the principle of confidentiality. Now, having understood the principles, we need to understand also that there are certain exceptions which are possible in this case when we discuss the principle of confidentiality. Firstly, if the client or the individual has done or is about to undertake anything which is considered dangerous in terms of attempting suicide or attempting any harm to himself, herself, or anyone else whom he may have aggression against, or if the client needs to be referred to another professional authority. In such cases, yes, there is something called shared confidentiality, which we need to utilize. And in such situations, the clients or the individual in confidence, we need to take the client, or the service user in confidence and explain to them or convince them about the reasons for what we are calling shared confidentiality. Some people call it breaking confidentiality, but I would like to call it shared confidentiality because we are undertaking it for the purpose of enabling the client to engage with his or her situation, utilize the helping profession and the helping professional's skills and experience to enable the client to move forward in the process of resolving his or her issue at hand. Now, I would like to bring you back to this document so that we glance through it before moving forward. As I mentioned in the beginning, this module is divided into four blocks. The first block is titled Human Behavior and Social Environment. It comprises four units. The first unit is titled Social Casework Practice in the Indian Context. Unit 2 is Behavioral Concepts for Understanding the Clients. Unit 3 is titled Scope of Social Casework, Nature of Problems to be Addressed. Unit 4 is titled Components of Casework. We will be discussing these tomorrow in further detail, but I would like you to have an overview of this module so that you know what we are going to be engaging with. In the first block, as just mentioned, which is titled Human Behavior and Social Environment, the attempt is to learn about social casework practice in India and how casework is related to individual behavior. We also need to appreciate, it is not mentioned here, but I would like to add that casework in itself is a borrowed term. and it was the medical model which led us as professionals to use the term case in casework. So we need to also dwell on that as we move ahead in our journey. The second block is titled social casework. As I mentioned, now some colleges have started using the term working with individuals instead of social casework. So the second block in this module deals with the techniques required by the caseworker or the professional social worker to enable the client to deal with his or her their problem. It also elaborates on the process. It also elaborates on the process of social casework and the tools for practicing social casework. So this business about tools is extremely important for us to understand that as professionals, what are the tools required by us and which we need to utilize for operationalizing the casework practice. The third block is titled Basics of Counseling, wherein one is introduced to the concept of counseling, its goals, theories, and the models of practice. An attempt is made for the student learner to understand the supportive techniques and the behavioral techniques in counseling, the cognitive and the psychoanalytical techniques widely used by practitioners. In the fourth block, which is titled Interviewing and Recording, one will study about the interviewing and different techniques and processes which we engage in when we interview our clients and how casework recording is undertaken. In the process, one will also learn about communication patterns and documentation in social casework. As I mentioned, the first unit of block one. Block one, as I mentioned, is titled Human Behavior and Social Environment. As you can see on the screen, what is Honak telling me in the chat? If second year students' contact numbers are there, then I don't have second year students' contact number, Honak. It would be good if you create a WhatsApp group because you have your classmates' numbers. I only have an email from Dr. Panigrahi and this Google Meet link for my classes. So I would request you to reach out to your classmates if they wish to be part of this module teaching. It would be greatly appreciated because you have been together last semester and some communication would have happened with all of you in that semester. So some numbers probably you would have. I do not have your numbers as of now, right? So coming back to this block on human behavior and social environment, which is the first block of MSW007. It has four units. The first unit is titled Social Casework Practice in the Indian Context. And the module expects us to understand human behavior in the context of a progressive Indian society, enabling us to establish a relationship between casework and individual behavior and the trends in casework practice in India. In the second unit, which is titled Behavioral Concepts for Understanding the Clients, certain aspects of personality factors influencing personality have been discussed. And it's important to flag that our age-old stereotypes of normal behavior and abnormal behavior need to be processed when we are discussing this unit. The third unit on scope of social casework deals with the nature of problems which tend to arise as part of our development sector, which can be addressed through casework and the fields of casework practice. The fourth unit is titled Components of Casework. While we are moving ahead, I would also like to highlight, I'm writing in the chat also, that there is a open source called EPG Pathshala, where a lot of professional social workers from Nirmala Niketan, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and other colleges of social work had contributed to online audios, videos, and self-study material when about a few years ago, when EPG Pathshala was created by the Ministry of Human Resource Development. And all the topics which we are discussing as part of this module are also been written out by professional social workers, which you can refer to as a supplement to your text. Some of us are good with or feel more comfortable with the audio material, so you can listen to the audios and the videos which have been created as part of this exercise. So you can go to EPG Pathshala on the net, type social work, access the social work modules which are created, because there are every profession, every course has been outlined as part of this EPG Pathshala module. So you can go to the social work section of the this module and read more in detail. So coming back to this unit one of block one, social casework practice in the Indian context, written by Professor Archana Dasi. She's a professor at Jamia Millia Islamia. She has highlighted in this module the following: the objectives of the unit, understanding human behavior, reference to modern society and social work, social casework practice in India, indigenization of casework practice, summing up, and highlighting the readings and the references as part of this module. So I will begin with the objectives which she has highlighted. We have been through an hour now of this space. I have responded to the questions you have put on the chat. Anybody would like to speak their mind, express their opinion, have any doubt which you would like to flag here before I proceed?
Madam, I want to know one thing. As I had mentioned in the chat, controlling the emotional.
Controlling what is your understanding of that? Yeah, I got that. I read it in the chat and I was waiting for you to also speak up, because it also comes from what experiences you have had as a professional social worker. I think you mentioned that you have been working in the field. So I would also like you to share your thoughts on what kind of work you have been undertaking in the field, so I can refer to your fieldwork experiences when we discuss this element. Please tell me.
I'm working as a social worker, and we visit different SAG groups, and we make awareness programs among the youths, and also make awareness programs on legal and RTI. Then we speak on dowry systems, which is the evil of the society. So all those things I speak, but emotional control. Sometimes if the people come and cry just to make me emotional, that they are in this situation, they are very poor condition. Sometimes they just to get some money, they cry in that way. So sometimes I become very emotional and I even give the money and other things from my pocket. Then after some days or some months later, I came to know that they are just making money and they are fundraising. So they make in that way emotional to the people. So some cases I become very emotional, and as a simple heart, I think that there might be need and I provide. So how to control this emotional? So it might be come on under that. So I was asking to speak on this little bit.
Okay. So I have additional question. What is your designation now, if I may ask, Hona, as a social worker?
As a social worker now, I'm a area manager for area East.
So since how long you are working as an area manager now?
I have been working from last 3 years as an area manager, but I'm in the social sector from last 12 years.
12 years. And earlier, what kind of job profile did you have as part of this profession?
I was coordinating different programs and activities. I used to go to fields conducting different types of awareness program or speaking on livelihood programs, how to save money and how to create SHGs for their benefit of the future and for their next generation, and how to stay away from drug addiction and drinking wine. All these things I used to speak in the field with the community people.
Okay, so I'm trying to ask you these questions because it is important to understand your background and your approach to working in the field when we need to answer this question. Also, we need to accept that we may be having certain limitations as professional social workers which we may need to address. Is it possible that that is a possibility?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So, having said that, I would like to let you know, let me get my headphones because I think I'm disturbing somebody's. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I would like to let you know that many a time when we are thinking that we are being taught certain principles and we are unable to practice it, then we need to reflect on what is it about us as professional social workers which may be coming in the way of our being too empathetic or too much going out of the way. It is possible that we will falter in our working lives. It's not possible that we will do everything right the first time. Even simple things like if we are told that you have to prepare a meal in your house for yourself, we will make 10 times. Sometimes the spice will be more, sometimes the vegetable will be less cooked, sometimes the chapati will be not formed properly or not cooked properly, or the rice may be not overcooked. Similarly, when we are working in the field, we have to understand that learning skills and practicing skills are two different things. So what skills you have learned as a professional social worker in 12 years of your working life, if you are saying that you have been in the field for 12 years, and what skills you could practice in the process, and what kind of training or guidance you got in terms of practicing those skills is very important when we talk of controlled emotional involvement. Taking my own example as school social worker, I worked for 11 years as a school social worker in a very prestigious school in Delhi. And I was very empathetic to the student community, to their behavioral issues, to their academic performance, to their lack of understanding with some of the faculty or the teachers in the school, with the fact that when some of them approached me, like I was also working as a counselor. So when some of them approached me as a counselor, then maybe one teacher told some particular student that you are not a case. Why you are going to counselor? You are not a counseling case. So this two words hurt her so much that she stopped coming to me as a social, although I was available as a school social worker. And I was also undertaking outreach program for the community. And she was one of the volunteers who was coming with me after school hours for outreach work in the community. I was engaging with a project called Help Adopt a Grand Project. So this Adopt a Grand Project was a project I had undertaken with Helpage India in collaboration with my school as a first-time project of helping the vulnerable marginalized elderly women. So why I'm giving you this example? To enable you to understand that having untold emotional involvement by a professional social worker requires practice. And we need to, everyday basis, coming back from work, analyze and reflect How did the day go? What went wrong? What went right? What could I have done differently? If I got carried away first time in giving money, can I help the community people or the self-help group by engaging in crowdfunding so that my personal money is not invested, but if the self-help group decides to give that money, it is their responsibility. Otherwise, we will take our professional journey personally. So how not to become personal in a professional relationship is extremely important for us if we want to practice controlled emotional involvement. There will be many instances in our working lives where not only our clients or beneficiaries will ask for money or some resources, but probably even our emotions could be at stake in reaching out or being empathetic to our clients or our service users, as they are called. So how you will do it is entirely possible when you reflect, keep the boundaries between personal and professional strict and firm and tight. When you look back at how your day has been so that you and I don't repeat the same mistakes as professional social workers. When we find alternatives to what is possible and not immediately respond to a situation here and now. So if we have give it one day or 2 days and say that, okay, you need the money today, let me think about it. Let me discuss it with my coworker. Let me discuss it in my agency. Let me discuss it with my senior. Let me discuss it with my fieldwork supervisor. Let me discuss it with my faculty. There are so many ways which we can undertake, which will give us the space and the time to process what we need to do so that we do not get emotionally involved in the situation. And that process is also called self-care. So self-care for a professional social worker is as important when we are undertaking casework, group work or community work or any aspect of engaging with people in the helping profession. It can happen to doctors, it can happen to nurses, it can happen to psychotherapists, it can happen to counselors, it can happen to physiotherapists, it can happen to anyone, what you are asking. But it is up to us, because everyone will devise different ways of maintaining boundaries, of telling oneself that how not to get carried away beyond what is required of us as professionals. Have I answered your question or do you want me to elaborate?
Yes, yes, madam. Thank you. And okay. Also, sometimes I trust very easily. So
yes.
To become an emotional worker. But now I got that personal and professional boundaries need to be maintained. That's
very good. Very nice. Very good. So now I am proceeding with what I was discussing as part of the objectives of this module, because I was just going through this objectives of unit. After studying this unit, you will be able to understand human being in the context of modern society. One second. Then understand social casework and individual behavior. Know the trends in social casework practice in India and understand the extent of indigenization of casework practice. So this introduction is there, which you can read on social casework, how it emerged. What is the understanding we need of human beings socially, psychologically, but more than that, our understanding of human beings as we have evolved in the 21st century, because we are also part of that society whom we are trying to help or reach out to. So that human being or the client we are trying to help is not different in some senses from what we ourselves are. So we need to understand that we are also part of the society in which the client is staying or living, and that the problem with which the client is coming to us could also be a problem which we could have been part of. So when we are discussing social casework practice in Indian context, we need to also understand what is the history of the Indian context, what is the theories of karma and dharma which we are practicing in the Indian context, which may be highlighted or may not be highlighted in the text, because a lot of our text is borrowed from the West. So when we are talking about love, respect, humility, helping, bonding, networking, partnerships, culture, then what is it that is required of us in appreciating the indigenization of casework practice, which already existed in our literature, but which we did not probably study in that way in the previous years when we ourselves did social work as a professional course. So when we are discussing or understanding our clients in the Indian context, we need to understand that we refer, depending on the cultural context, like I or Amma or brother or sister or Bhai Sahab or Behenji or Didi or Bhaiya or Dada. These are terms which come very easily to us in the Indian context. And we should not undermine this terminology because it enables us to bond better with the client, even though we are maintaining professional boundaries. So this module also talks of that indigenization process. And it also refers to the Gita, to the inner dignity, which is mentioned in the Gita, to the process of karma and dharma, which is there in Ramayana and Mahabharata. And you might know that some books have been written with called Mahabharata Unraveled. So, or Ramayana Unraveled. So, sometimes we as social workers may need to read some of these texts in a different context if we want to do justice to our profession in dealing with clients in the Indian context. So this is very valuable that at the outset, Professor Archana Dasi has talking of indigenization of casework practice in India. When we come to Unit 2, which talks of behavioral concepts for understanding our clients, again, this unit is written by Professor Archana Dasi. She speaks of the objectives, the concept of human needs, the structure of personality, the factors influencing personality, what defense mechanisms clients may use, what is the concept of social role, and then the mention of readings and references is given. So what are the objectives which are spelled out in this unit? This module says that the aim of this unit is to provide you the basic knowledge of behavioral concepts for understanding the client. After reading this unit, you should be able to understand what are common human needs, understand the structure of personality and factors influencing personality development, have an understanding of several defense mechanisms, which include denial, rationalization, displacement, identification, compensation, fantasy, and projection, and also understand the concept of social role. So somebody called Grace Matthew, who has been very revered in our profession, professional social worker, had formulated 5 prepositions which constitute a convenient framework for understanding human behavior. So what are those prepositions which have been formulated? We need to look at them. 1, an individual's behavior is conditioned by his or her environment and his or her life experiences. 2, for human growth and development, it is essential that certain basic needs be met. 3, emotional needs are real and they cannot be met or removed through intellectual reasoning. So it's just not about rationalizing your way through with a client, but there are other aspects which need to be understood and dealt with as a professional social worker. 4, behavior is purposeful and is in response to the individual's physical and emotional needs. And 5, other people's behavior can be understood only in terms of one's own emotional and intellectual comprehension. So based on our own emotional comprehension, based on our own intellectual comprehension, only we can understand other people's behavior. This is a very important and relevant part which Dr. Grace Matthew has highlighted, and we need to come back to this as we move along. Then, according to Maslow's theory of hierarchy, which we have been taught and read earlier also in another context of psychological work, psychology, we need to understand that an individual has basic physiological needs. He or she has safety needs. We also have needs of belonging. We also have self-esteem needs. And last but not the least, needs of self-actualization. Now, these five aspects are very important for us to understand if we are going to work with clients as part of our professional journey. So I will just go through them again so that we don't lose out on the fact that physiological needs refers to basic needs of food, water, sex. Safety needs refers to safety from disease. Safety needs refers to safety from disease, pain, physical damage, natural hazards or man-made hazards. Belongingness needs refers to the need to belong, to be loved, and to be loved. Esteem needs refers to the need to be recognized, accepted, appreciated, and identified by significant others in our lives. They could be a spouse, it could be a partner, it could be a live-in relationship, it could be a parent, it could be a sibling. And finally, self-actualization needs, which entails the need to work for self-fulfillment and self-growth. So with this understanding, we move to what personality means for us as professional social workers. Why is understanding the personality of the client an important requirement? What do we mean when we say behavior? And why do we need to understand it in a more detailed way? So personality is the overall picture of the characteristic behavior of the individual. Behavior includes thinking, feeling, speaking, and doing. And the concept of personality growth we need to understand is complex. One second, I need to keep my phone on charging. Understanding personality requires that we understand what it means by behavior. Behavior includes thinking, feeling, speaking, and doing. So the concept of personality itself is quite complex and requires special knowledge and skills for us to identify the different aspects of personality of individuals or of clients whom we are going to be dealing with. Then, of course, there is a mention of Freud's understanding of ego, superego, and moving on to the factors which influence personality. So apparently, a well-balanced personality means the fulfillment of needs and adaptation to the environment. Over the course of time, number of obstacles have been identified which could be the cause of causing conflicts among individuals in terms of their personality. One aspect identified by the author is faulty parenting. The second is socialization. The third is overprotection in some cases. The fourth is strong superego. Fifth is an superego-ego balance or a conflict in it, which could cause reasons for personality malfunction. So what is it about socialization which is important for us to understand as professional social workers? And why is socialization such an important aspect which always is coming to the surface for clients' resolution of problems? So most of the ego functions of growth develop through the process of socialization. Socializing agents are parents, teachers, elders, elder siblings, elder members in the family, teachers in the classroom. And most of them have some understanding about the needs of the child, but they also play a role in spelling out the do's and the don'ts in the growing up years. So the socialization process operates within the agenda of legitimate freedom and restraints, which I'm talking of as do's and don'ts. It also pans out in the way of rewards and punishments, that if you do what I ask you to do or what is acceptable, you will get a reward. If you disobey or do things which are not acceptable, then you will be punished for the same. So all these impacts are personality. The other important agenda here is that of overprotection. In some homes, where the parents or the older siblings try to be possessive about the younger ones, it tends to hamper the development of the ego. So if the children have too smooth, too comfortable, hunky-dory life without having to make any efforts, everything is provided to them, there is no flexing of physical, intellectual or emotional muscles, there is no scope for any conflict which may arise because of differences in the household in terms of how we relate to our helpers in the house or how we relate to people less fortunate, or how if something is not available to us, how will we handle the situation, or something like postponement of gratification, ki abhi mujhe khilona chahiye to abhi khareed ke do. What is a reality orientation? Sometimes lack of it tends to lead to overprotected children. And that in adult life sometimes tends to be a problematic situation when we have to adjust with our partners or our spouses who may come from a different orientation or a different socialization. So what do we mean then by strong superego in this situation? It means a person is guided by certain principles and standards of behavior. If the parents themselves have a very strong superego, then it is easier for children to imitate them and themselves form a strong superego. But families which try to inculcate values in their children, as I mentioned, by punishment or intimidation, dara ke unko ya dhamka ke ki tumko punish karenge agar tum hamari baat nahi manoge, it is likely that such children may accept parental teaching in a superficial way and they may rebel or develop a super ego which is rigid, which will impact their adult life and could cause issues in terms of their relationships with adults. The last but not the least is a balance between the ego and the superego. In a healthy ego-superego relationship, the guilt feelings generated by the superego are handled effectively by the ego so that other functions of ego are not affected by the guilt feelings. When the superego is... Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, sorry. When the superego is rigid and punitive, the superego doer becomes ill-matched, creating situations in which guilt overwhelms the ego. So it affects the personality. For their example, there are individuals who commit suicide because they are unable to cope with their own guilt feelings. So all these aspects are important when we are undertaking casework, when we are understanding the factors which influence personality development, when we are understanding personality types, and when we are understanding our clients who approach us with their issues. Now, when we are understanding personality types and personality issues or maladaptation of any person which could cause an issue in adult life, we also need to understand what are defense mechanisms and how they are used by individuals. So that when we are dealing with clients, we need to be able to identify them and we need to address them in a very sensitive way. So what are the defense mechanisms? What is a defense mechanism is also explained in this module. It clearly says that socialization helps us in social adjustments, but adjustments are complex and depend on a number of elements. Social adjustments help to fulfill the needs in accordance with the demands of society. But sometimes in meeting the demands of society, we may face consequences of frustration, which may lead to hostility or anger or destructive behavior or silence or withdrawal. And these pan out, these behaviors which occur in response to anxiety could be like we are swearing or using abusive language or overeating or smoking, or indulging in any vigorous physical activity, or talking too much to others, or panicking because we are thinking through the anxiety situation but unable to deal with it. So then in that situation, clients tend to use defense mechanisms which distorts their perception and reasoning. So defense mechanisms again are more complex than the coping devices. So what are the defense mechanisms which tend to be used by clients and which we need to understand as professional social workers? As I mentioned earlier, it could be denial, It could be rationalization, it could be displacement, it could be identification, it could be compensation, or it could be projection. So the first defense mechanism, which is titled denial, needs to be understood. If we are going to identify it, then we need to understand. So we will be able to. So what is denial? Denial is the shutting of reality in context which causes excessive anxiety. So maybe some situation is causing excess anxiety in me. I'm unable to deal with it. So in my mind, I'm shutting off the reality. For example, a parent who refuses to accept that his or her child is disabled or mentally challenged or born with a hearing problem, he or she may, in his mind, shut off the reality. It is possible that the ideas which the parents have regarding a mental impairment or a disability or a hearing problem are such that they cause undue anxiety in them. So it leads to use of denial, ki ye ho hi nahi raha hai. So in a defensive way, they are in a denial ki ye reality hai. What is the other second defense mechanism we are discussing? It is called rationalization. What is the meaning of rationalization? Rationalization refers to substituting good reasons for real reasons so that the actions may appear justified, logical, and socially laudable. It seeks to make irrational look rational. So kuch cheez irrational hai, lekin hamara dimag usko rationalize karta hai. Wo kehta hai nahi, aisa hi hai. By providing good reasons. For example, a man makes money through unfair means aur usko charitable purpose ke liye use kar deta. So if he says he is using bad means, that means using unfair means to make money, but charity mein de deta hai, gareeb ko de deta hai, toh it is called rationalizing his behavior. Theek hai? This is the meaning of rationalizing. What is the third defense mechanism we are discussing? The third defense mechanism is called displacement. What is the meaning of displacement? When the direct expression of an aroused emotion is inhibited, the emotion may be discharged by transferring it to the neutral object or idea. This transfer from its original to unrelated object is called displacement. What example is being given? For example, annoyance of a person towards the boss. Ho sakta hai ki main apne boss se naraaz hoon kyunki unhone meri baat samjhi nahi ya maani nahi. Lekin main boss ko kuch bol nahi sakti because he is senior to me and I may get retaliation from him. So unknowingly, I am coming back home and shouting at my wife. That is called displacement. The next defense mechanism is called sublimation. What is sublimation? It refers to a behavior when displacement leads to a socially valued practice or activity. Example kya bataya ja raha hai? A young woman who fails to satisfy her needs of family and children of her own, sublimates the desire, usko daba dete, sublimates the desires by taking to nursery teaching or nursing. The substitute activities are of a higher order than the blocked activity. So sublimation refers to a behavior. Who has undertaken the behavior in this case? This young woman. जब क्या होता है डिस्प्लेसमेंट, डिस्प्लेसमेंट मतलब जिसको गुस्सा करना है या जिसको ध्यान देना है. किसकी बात हो रही थी? फैमिली और चिल्ड्रन. उनको नहीं दे पा रही, उनकी नीड्स फुलफिल नहीं कर पा रही. सो व्हाट डज शी डू? शी और ही लीड गोज अहेड विद अ सोशली वैल्यूड प्रैक्टिस. सोशली वैल्यूड क्या प्रैक्टिस है? कि नर्सरी टीचिंग या नर्सिंग करना. तो बच्चों को ध्यान न दे के वो दूसरी जगह अपनी एनर्जी, टाइम और काबिलियत को डिस्प्लेस करती है, पर सब्लिमेट भी करती है, दबाती भी है अपने ओरिजिनल रिक्वायरमेंट को, इसलिए उसको सब्लिमेशन कहा जाता है. द सब्स्टिट्यूट एक्टिविटी मतलब वो नर्सिंग इज द सब्स्टिट्यूट एक्टिविटी आर ऑफ अ हायर ऑर्डर देन द ब्लॉक्ड एक्टिविटी. व्हाट इज आइडेंटिफिकेशन एज अ डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म? आइडेंटिफिकेशन involves unconscious placing of oneself in the situation of another person and assuming the characteristic of that person. It is the practice of feeling that you are in the role of someone. So dusre ke role ko ke sath aap identify karte ho. Identification is common in several areas of social living. So hero worship helps to boost one's own prestige तो कई बार हम दूसरे की बहुत पूजा करते कि वो ना मेरा रोल मॉडल है। तो हीरो वर्शिप हेल्प्स टू बूस्ट आवर ओन प्रेस्टीज, हमें बहुत किक मिलता है, थ्रिल मिलता है, लेकिन अपनी गलतियां, अपनी खामियां हम छुपा लेते हैं बाय डूइंग दैट। व्हाट इज द नेक्स्ट डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म वी आर डिस्कसिंग? इट इज कॉल्ड रिग्रेशन। रिग्रेशन रिफर्स टू रिवर्टिंग टू लेस मैच्योर बिहेवियर्स विच आर कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ अर्लियर स्टेजेस ऑफ डेवलपमेंट। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अ सिक्स ईयर ओल्ड बॉय और अ यंग बॉय और अ माइनर बॉय हु कुड स्पीक क्लियरली as he is growing older starts blabbering like a small baby after the death of his favorite grandmother. ye ek example hai. so that process it's called regression. ki main chote bacche ki tarah baat kar rahi hu jabki main bada ho gaya hu, theek se baat karna mujhe aa gaya hai, lekin meri dadi ya nani ke guzarne ke baad one resorts to behavior jisme hame attention bhi milegi aur hum cope nahi kar paye. so it is a coping mechanism basically. theek hai. now next defense mechanism which is highlighted here is compensation. compensation is an ego device against the pressure of excessive guilt feelings. so kisi feeling of inadequacy ko pura karne ke liye many individuals engage in this kind of compensatory activity. so compensation may be direct or indirect, desirable or undesirable. direct compensation kya hoti hai? it consists of an intensive striving for success. an intensive driving for success when the individual attempts to counteract the feelings of inferiority in one field of success, he or she is engaging in indirect compensation. so compensation can be desirable or undesirable. kai baar hame feeling of inferiority hoti hai to hum usko compensate karne ke liye kuch aur activity karte hain. kai baar humko feeling of superiority hoti hai to hum compensate karne ke liye dusra tarah ka behavior. second last defense mechanism which is being discussed is fantasy. fantasy is also known as daydreaming. kai baar the mind branches out into something else because you want to get rid of your pressing anxiety or pressing concern or pressing issue which you are unable to deal with. so it is a flight of imagination, flight into fantasy land bolte hain. one escapes the hardships and unpleasant aspects of real life by fantasizing about something. last but not the least in the defense mechanisms is known as projection. what is projection? projection refers to attributing and observing in others one's own impulses and traits. matlab hum dusre vyakti mein unconscious motive ya desire ya defect dekhte hain and using others as a screen on which we project our own mental state and process. this externalization of personal defects, koi hum mein khamiyan hain, hum mein kamiyan hain, usko hum project karte hain dusre par because that enables us to protect our ego against self criticism. it protects us by criticizing others faults. one second. we cannot criticize others' faults directly. so by criticizing others' faults which one possesses, hum khud mein hai wo galtiyan, one tries to evade the pain or the painful recognition ke hum mein wo galtiyan hai, to hum project karte hain dusre pe wo galtiyan. now we come to the concept of social role. the social role of the person is the pattern or mode of behaving related to the position in the social group. so whether we are playing the role of father, mother, brother, sister, teacher, student, principal, that role is extremely important for us in our daily life because social roles can be analyzed around three aspects. what are those three aspects? those three aspects are as follows. and two, the prescriptions and expectations that govern the actions and relationships. and third, the evaluation of the assessment which is mainly on the performance task ki hum wo role ko perform kaise kar rahe. most of the problems of social functioning are with reference to role performance. सो व्हाट आर द रीजंस फॉर पुअर रोल परफॉर्मेंस, क्योंकि अगर क्लाइंट हमारे पास आ रहा है तो इट्स पॉसिबल दैट दे आर कमिंग टू अस बिकॉज ऑफ सम रोल विच दे हैव नॉट बीन एबल टू परफॉर्म वेल और विच हैज इम्पैक्टेड देयर एडल्ट लाइफ और विच हैज इम्पैक्टेड देयर सोशल फंक्शन. So an individual's performance of one or more of the major roles may be inadequate, it may be defective, or it may be impaired because of the following reasons. One, non-fulfillment of needs. Two, divergent role expectations. Three, any physical illness or a mental health issue. Four, lack of material resources or lack of non-material resources. Five, any physical or mental disabilities which they may be confronted with, lack of preparation for the role as a parent or as an older sibling or as a teacher or as a principal, and last but not the least, conflict between two roles. So I could have be playing the role as a mother as well as working professional. So there could be conflict between the two roles which could cause dissonance. So above seven factors are not exclusive of each other. They could be overlapping. There could be more than one reason for this impairment or inadequacy of being able to perform certain roles. The concept of socialization is very relevant for understanding human behavior. And many more sociological constructs like our cultural practices, social control, social institutions, are equally relevant to social work practice if we are required to bring about effective changes in human behavior. So then there is a summing up of this module, which we have already been through in details. There is a mention of the references, and then we are moving to the unit 3, which is the scope of social work, social casework, and what are the nature of the problems which are required to be addressed if we are going to become effective caseworkers. Again, this unit has laid down the objectives. Then it talks about failure in coping, the fields of casework practice, and summing up with the readings. The objectives as outlined in this module and the unit 3 is as follows. One, we need to understand the usual coping patterns which are ineffective in the face of some problems and what are the fields of social casework practice. Again, there is mention of Grace Matthew because she has been a stalwart in the and written a book in 2011 on the issues, the aspects of casework practice. The failure in coping largely which has to be addressed, with which the clients could come to us, has been outlined. The reasons why individuals face coping practices which are ineffective have been outlined. There are five categories which have been listed. The first is the lacking of material resources. Second is the misconceptions about situations and relationships and lack of appropriate information. Third is illness or health-related handicaps. Fourth is emotional distress resulting from stressful situation. And fifth is personality features or deficiencies. So the first is lack of material resources. It could be that due to poverty or due to unemployment or due to housing problems or to related factors, there is lack of monetary resources available, which could cause a client to be unable to cope with his or her living conditions. A lot of it got surfaced during the pandemic when people lost their jobs suddenly. Some of it is still panning out in terms of retrenchment and jobs being given to others in other countries where the lesser salaries have to be paid, also due to emergence of AI. So the material resources or the lack of job situations can get aggravated and may not necessarily lead to dire issues of poverty, but it could lead to impacting a client's lifestyle, because he or she or they may be having a certain standard of living which they may not be able to maintain because of losing the job or because of one partner losing their job. So the second major aspect here is titled misconceptions about situations and relationships. So sometimes clients have wrong notions about things which prevent people from handling difficult situations. Many people have superstitious beliefs which prevent them from taking medical treatment or taking alternative healthcare facilities. The third is titled illness or health related handicaps, which could be a cause. For example, the breadwinner of the family may be unwell and all other members may have to face a variety of problems and make plan B. The fourth is emotional distress, which may occur due to stressful situations. And last but not the least is defective features of one personality, which we discussed that what could be the reasons for causing distress in adult life or for clients to have to come to us with issues related to personality types of deficiencies in personality or human behavior. So the scope of social casework can be determined on the basis of person in context, the problem which has arisen, and the purpose with which the client has approached the organization. From here, we come to fields of casework practice. Primary settings like family welfare agency is definitely listed as one of the settings. In a medical setting, which is a secondary setting for casework, we need to understand that practicing as a medical social worker has been the first. In India, casework practice in some places in connection with medicine, as I mentioned, is medical social workers in outpatient departments or in special clinics. Casework is also practiced in institutions where mental health services are provided, like child guidance clinics, health hospitals, healthcare centers, mental health clinics, psychiatry departments in hospitals, and crisis intervention centers. As mentioned, social casework historically has been practiced with terminally ill patients or chronically ill patients, and also in residential institutions, in correctional settings, in connection with juvenile welfare board or adult courts, or probation or aftercare work, casework is an important part of the practice component. In children's homes, which are operationalized under the provisions of the Juvenile Justice Act, where custodial care is extremely important, casework is undertaken. In homes for the elderly, sometimes earlier they used to be called homes for the aged, now they are called senior citizens' homes. In school social work, as I mentioned through my example, casework and counseling are important. And it is also caseworkers' role is important in adoption services or in foster care homes, in organizations working with the disabled population, whether it's in terms of care, rehabilitation, vocational training, providing services related to government provisions, advocating, reducing social discrimination against differently abled. All these are spaces where casework is practiced. Casework is also practiced in cases where there is need for disaster management or of victims of disaster, man-made or otherwise. So all these have been listed as very important aspects of casework practice in our module. Last component, of course, in this block are the components of casework. The four major components highlighted by Perlman are person, problem, place, and process, the four P's as they are called. And this unit, one attempts to understand the different components of casework, appreciate the need to focus on the multipurpose system of the client, develop knowledge that a social worker must understand while providing service to a client in a particular agency, understand the meaning and dimensions of the problems which the social worker is confronted with, understand the functions and purpose of the agency where the clients are coming, and gaining an insight on the process of dealing with the challenges. So social casework is defined as a process used by human welfare agencies to help individuals to cope effectively with their problems in social functioning. This is a very important definition because it relates, as I mentioned, to the four components of casework known as the four P's. The four P's are as follows: the person, the problem, the place, and the process. So the person who's coming, as I said, as synonyms like client, caseworkers, beneficiary, the target group, and also, as I mentioned, is known as the service user these days. So the person who's coming to the organization for help, originally known as the client, they could ask for help for themselves, they could be referred by another professional, they could be referred by a family member, they could be referred by a neighbor or a friend. Those who do not seek help but require help are referred by social support network. So it's important to understand what Bystic identified as the seven needs of clients in the helping profession. They are as follows: to be dealt with as an individual, to express feelings both positive and negative, to be accepted as a person of worth, which I explained to you when I was doing the philosophical principles, which are required for us to understand, to have a sympathetic understanding and respond to the feelings expressed, to be neither judged, that means that non-judgmental approach has to be used, to make choices and decisions concerning one's own life, means that right to self-determination, and finally, that the client's information needs to be kept confidential. So these important aspects are highlighted, and one very important component which is flagged here is that of being and becoming. So what is it about the client and his expectations which are shaped and judged, where the client is attempting to play his or her social role but is facing a situation where he needs the help of the social worker? And what is the understanding of the social worker in enabling the client to cope with the situation, to accept help, to understand, to grow in the process of solving the problem? So the problem, again, is a very typical word which has been used, which we try to unpack when we say that it is a situation that presents uncertainty, perplexity, or difficulty for a client. So when does a situation become problematic for a client? And when does a problematic situation become appropriate for social work concern? These are two pressing and very relevant aspects which we will discuss in the last 10 minutes of our class today. When does a situation become problematic? And when does a problematic situation become appropriate for social work intervention? So in attempting to understand these, we need to understand also that what are the dimensions of how a problem arises in itself, or how a situation becomes problematic? The problem arises from some need or some obstacle or accumulation of frustration or maladjustment by the client unknowingly. The social functioning problem may rest in interpersonal relationships. So the interpersonal relationships of the client could cause a problem to arise. The problem may also rest in an inability to negotiate with the system in the environment. So everyone's environment is different. Patient in a hospital may be unable to cope. I had a colleague whose husband had a sudden cardiac arrest day before yesterday. And she was calling me without texting, so I didn't know why she was calling. And when I returned her call, she was unable to explain to me because she was so upset, embarrassed, and uncomfortable to say that her husband had had a cardiac arrest. And she needed help from my relative who was a consultant in another hospital, whether my relative could reach out to the doctor who had undertaken the operation. I was extremely lucky. She was also extremely lucky that when I texted my relative that, do you know these two doctors in another hospital? My relative had worked with that doctor in about 10 years ago and said that she would reach out to the doctor once she got the information about the patient and the ward number where he was taken after the operation, because he was on ventilator after the open heart surgery. So what I'm trying to say is that sometimes even as educated people, mature people, we are embarrassed to discuss our problem which has arisen suddenly. And we may not be very comfortable with seeking help. So we need to understand that if in a normal situation, this is how we feel, what would a client feel who may be having more concerns or issues in approaching us as a professional? The problem rests in inadequate or inappropriate role performance. Or he or she may not be having the preparation to carry out a social role, as I mentioned, that I may not be ready to be a parent, but I may have had a baby. Or there may be disturbances due to disorder resulting in some turmoil or constriction or distortion. So I may be having some mental health issue which may have got unnoticed, but which emerged as part of my adult life or my being in a relationship. There could be discrepancies between expectations of a person and demands of the various segments of that person's environment. So it's possible that before marriage, there may not be many expectations, but after marriage, one partner may feel that they are being, that there is a lot of expectations from the marriage and the family in which the person is married. So these cause adjustment issues, whether it is discrepancies between environmental demands and personal needs. Sometimes our life situations change, and as a young girl, I may be required to be a caregiver for my mother or a father. And that may cause some dissonance in my social life, in my studies, or in my personal life. So all these become issues which the social worker needs to engage with, which the social worker needs to understand, which the social worker needs to appreciate. When we use the third P, the place, which is mostly the social service agency or the social work department of another human welfare agency. This term agency sometimes is used in such a way that we feel that we need to understand it correctly, because it has a history from British casework literature of the 19th century. But in today's context, we use the word institution, organization, NGO. But the institutions in casework practice could be a school, it could be a child guidance clinic, it could be a children's department of a hospital, it could be an aftercare home. All these can be referred to as social casework agencies. And we need to understand it in the context of how Perlman used it many, many years ago as a social agency, but today it is interpreted as a government department or an NGO or a community center or an outreach. Somewhere an outreach program is undertaken and we have hired a community hall or a room to function as an outreach work in a community setting. So it could be an office of a field action project sometimes, where project work is undertaken, where our clients could approach us. So when we say agency, we need to understand it that social work is an agency-based profession. The agency is the immediate environment of the worker-client interaction, where the engagement takes place. The interaction takes place in an office, cabin, or a building identified as an agency. So depending on the location of that office or the agency, our rapport building process is initiated, or our introduction to the client takes place in terms of, please meet me in this particular place, in this particular office. So what are the characteristics of social casework agency depends on the kind of institution or organization where social casework is being practiced or requires to be practiced in terms of it being a helping profession. And last but not the least, the fourth P is the process, a progressive transaction between the professional helper, who is also known as caseworker, and the client. It consists of a series of problem-solving operations. It is not a one-day session. It is a series. So it's a process. There's a meaningful relationship established between the caseworker and the client. Process refers to the recurrent pattern of a sequence of change over time and in a particular direction. So it is recurrent. It has stages. It takes place over time. The attempt is to initiate the rapport building between the client and the social worker. It's a problem-solving process involving thinking, feeling, and acting. The casework process must include in its problem-solving help the fact that the caseworker needs to take stock of the situation, to need to understand whether any tangible means or resources are required, whether people are unable to solve their problems because of ignorance or the facts of the problems are not clear, how resolution is going to take place. The problem may lie with the person himself or herself, who may be a victim or a subject of victim. Some people find problems in solving a difficult situation because they may not have developed systematic habits of thinking and planning. So there are various reasons for why a client will approach you as a professional to seek help. The stages of problem solving process are as under. What is the preliminary statement of the problem? This is how you're going to write your report for casework, which we will go into next time, but I will just highlight it today and close for now. The stages of the problem solving process are as follows. One, preliminary statement of the problem. Two, statement of the preliminary assumptions about the nature of the problem. Three, selection and collection of information. Four, analysis of the information available. Five, development of a plan. Six, implementation of the plan. And finally, monitoring, evaluation, and follow-up. So with this, I'm coming to the conclusion of today's class, and we will begin the next class with these stages so that we can move on to block two and continue our discussion on this course effectively. I'm requesting Honak to find the other classmates who may be interested in the course and encourage them to the WhatsApp message to join. I'm grateful.
Last year also same thing happened, ma'am, because some of the students are joined for few courses and I could not meet them, any of them. Okay, because last year I could not attend any classes. I went to center and asked about the student's contact number. Huh. Then also I could not get. That is the problem. But last week we did such a way that first year people all together, they got all the numbers.
I see. Okay. No problem. So we will just thank you for joining despite you being alone. Thank Dr. Panigrahi and his team for enabling me to take this class. And we will see you again next time to continue, because I should conclude now. It is 6 p.m. All the best. See you again next time. Take care. And let's hope you are able to read some of what I have shared with you. Right? Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.